glad you are here this morning. Those of you that are joining us here in person and those of you that are joining us online, welcome. It looks like the bake sale is a pretty popular place to be this morning. So they'll shut that down eventually and bring everybody in here. But also, doesn't the room look great out there? As things are continuing to be improved and updated, next week you won't even recognize it when you come in. So they've got part of it done. The rest of it will be done this week. And when you come in next Sunday, be sure to check out the main lobby area. Today is Palm Sunday. It's the beginning of Holy Week. This is such a significant week for us, and we're going to talk about that a little bit later as we get into the service. Today, Jesus rides into Jerusalem. And people gather, and they're waving palm branches, and they're shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." What's going on today? What is it really all about? We gather today, and we do a similar thing. We lift up our voices, and we worship him together. I want to read a prayer to you out of the Book of Common Prayer that's designated for this day, and then we'll get into our time of worship together. Would you bow your hearts with me? Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in your tender love for us, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon himself our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering and come to share in his resurrection through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And you'll see here on the screen too is our call and response as we begin the service today. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Okay, wait, let's try that one more time. Here we go. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
Praise aloud, sing his praise aloud. sing praise. Oh, awake my soul and sing his praise along. Sing his praise along.
This morning, Holy Spirit, would you come and have your way in this place and in our hearts? We surrender before you right now, God. Would you help us be sensitive to you this morning? We love you and we lift you up on the highest praises.
Final breath, and it was finished. time this morning. All hail and all.
We thank you for the promise of your word that as we gather like this, you're among us and that you dwell within and inhabit the praises of your people. So God, we acknowledge you. We acknowledge your presence here with us today. Thank you for what you've done and are doing in our hearts. And I pray, God, that our hearts would stay open to you, that you would speak to us through your word, that we would encounter you at the table. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to encourage you to join me now in speaking a blessing over the next generation. They're not just the future of the church, they are the church now, and we want them to grow up hearing this blessing spoken over them. So I want you to join me, and then kids, if you have one of these, when I release you, you take it with you, because Pastor Eastman's going to use this in our kids' adventures today, so take your palm with you. Now, if you would turn and reach out to a kid nearby, grab a hand, and let's speak this blessing over them together. Almighty God, we turn our hearts toward our children, whom we welcome and value as members of your church. As their community of faith, may we believe in their potential and speak to their God-given destiny. May they grow in faith to love and serve you with all their hearts. May the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with them today and every day of their lives. Amen. Amen. Kids, you're released to go with Pastor Eastman to our kids' adventures. And before you sit down, would you take a moment and greet somebody?
Here with you today on such a significant start to the week. If you're visiting, we would just like to say welcome. We are so honored and excited that you chose to spend part of your Sunday morning with us. And if you are visiting, we would love to get connected with you. So if you're joining us in person, there's a couple different ways that you can do that. That black tap disc in front of you, if you touch the top of your phone to that, it'll take you to our digital connect card. And we also have paper connect cards at the resource tables in the back of the sanctuary. And if you're joining us online, you can click connect on your screen right now. And both the digital and the paper copies have an option for you to write down a praise report or a prayer request. We give these to our pastors because they love to stand in faith with you, whatever it is that you're going through. So feel free to fill that out either digitally or on the paper copy. At this time, we want to continue in worship by bringing our tithes and our offerings to the Lord, as this is a biblical act of worship modeled all throughout Scripture. Luke 6:38 says, "Give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you." Today, we have an opportunity to give generously, knowing that God will use it to bless those in need and do work in our hearts and our lives today. So I want to direct your attention to the screens for just a moment. There are multiple different ways that you can give this morning. If you use that disc in front of you at this time, it will take you to our giving platform. If you take out your smartphone and scan that QR code, it'll take you there as well. Or if you have our app, you can also give securely on that. If you're joining us in person, you can find an offering envelope in the seat back pocket in front of you, and you can drop that at any of the gray receptacles in the sanctuary. And if you're joining us online, you can click give on your chat right now. Today is Mission Sunday, so if you want to give to missions, you can do that in the same way online. Just select missions as the designation for the offering, or you can bring your offering to the globe during the closing song. And since it is Mission Sunday, I'm going to invite up Pastor Mark. He's going to let us know about our missions highlight. And he and a team just got back from St. Lucia late last night, so we can't wait to hear about that.
Suffering for Jesus in St. Lucia. It was awesome. There was Eric and Corin Sharp and their daughter Lauren, and then Diane Adcox and a friend of hers. There were six of us. We went to St. Lucia. We worked with, there we are right there. Is that beautiful or what? And then we went and worked with the Salvation Army and distributed food to the homeless. Fantastic. We also had an opportunity to do prayer walks and share the gospel in the Central Park downtown in the Castries of St. Lucia. And then we went to a school. Check out this next picture. This was a public school of 900 primary kids, and we had the opportunity to worship. There we go. We had an opportunity to worship and preach the gospel to 900 kids. We saw many people get saved. It was an awesome time. And so we just want to encourage you. We're going to do some more trips coming up. We've got a trip to Uganda in June, working with the COA. We've got a trip to Ghana in July, working at an orphanage. And we've got a trip to Thailand in August. We want to invite you to join us for one of those trips. It's a great way to spend a week or 10 days of your summer and get an opportunity to do some of the things I described. So what a privilege. Now, one of the things at this church, we are very committed to missions. We support like 100 missionaries. There's one of them right back there. And one of them that we support, we're going to pray for them today. His name is David Acuna. Some of you may know his parents, Ariel and Maria Paz. Anyway, David is a young man, just got married to Alyssa. And it is such a privilege to pray for him. They live in Thailand, but this is David's heart. He shared this with me personally. He said he wants to go to the hardest places in the world where they've never heard the gospel. That is his desire. So we want to pray for David and Alyssa this morning. Would you join me in praying for them? And then we'll also pray for the offering. Well, Lord, we thank you for this young man and his wife, David and Alyssa. We just ask you, God, to bless their marriage. And we ask you, God, to protect them. We ask you, God, to use them in Thailand. And then as they get direction from you on some of the hardest places in the world, would you speak to them, continue to protect them, and use them to get the gospel to these people who have never heard before. And Lord, we thank you for this church, so supportive of missions. And Lord, I pray that you will bless the offering this morning, the missions offering and the offering in general for the church, God. We thank you for the generosity of the people here. We pray for a blessing on the offering, Lord. Would you multiply it? We ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Mark. You know, it takes all kinds. People that get persecuted and people that suffer in St. Lucia. It takes all kinds. But it's so exciting to have a missions pastor who is so willing to lead trips all over the world. And we have one going out every month. So there's some way you can connect. I encourage you to talk to Mark in the missions corner after church if you want more information. Some of you have asked about the Heart for the House offering that we are receiving. I know many of you have been traveling over spring break and haven't had the updates. Our goal was to raise $175,000, and I'm happy to say that we surpassed that. We've gone beyond that. So over $180,000 so far, and some still continues to kind of come in a little bit. So thank you so much for your generosity for giving. The main lobby area is open today. It's not finished, but it's open and usable. You see some of the updates that have happened out there. Next Sunday, I want to encourage you to come a little bit early because you're going to want to walk around out there. There's still more improvements happening that hopefully everything will be finished by Easter. And so come and join us for that. But thanks again for giving. Also this week, while you were out doing your thing, sometimes people, you wonder what goes on at the church during the week. And this is one of the things that went on this week. Y'all know Eastman loves his drones. He has drones. He flies them everywhere and he gives them away. Well, this is a video he took with his drone this week during the, Yeah, can't you hear him? Guys, we got new air conditioners. And so this is, if you remember back during VBS, we had to bring extra air conditioners into that main lobby area because it was so hot out there. And it took 8 months to get them, but here they are. So taking out that 5,000-pound AC unit, it was quite an operation to see what was happening here this week. And there is Eastman out there flying his drone around. But we wanted you to see what's happening, to see the improvements that you helped make happen. Now, I promise you, we will not show you a video when we update the septic system. We're gonna just leave those details out because you know how important that is. And but this is what happened this week. Again, thank you so much for giving and being so generous and showing your heart for this house. This is our place to gather and worship. This is our place to do ministry. Thank you for being such a big part of that. It's a blessing. I also want to let you know that coming up is our second annual First Responders Conference. We did this last year, and we just wanted to reach out to those who are willing to put their lives on the line. When you call 911, these people show up every single day in our worst crisis. And they do it on a regular basis. And they put themselves in a lot of stressful situations and a lot of very difficult situations. And so we want to do a conference that was for them that would focus on their mental health and their spiritual health. And it was incredible. The response was amazing. So we're doing it again this year. It is free for all first responders and their families. We even have had some folks ask us that are, you know, ex-military or maybe current military, could they come and attend? Absolutely. This is for them as well. We want them to be here and get the benefit of, you know, the speakers and the resources that will be provided. There's a table right in the sanctuary lobby on your way out if you want to get more information about it and how you can be involved. One easy way is to become a business sponsor or to give some kind of one-time gift towards that conference. We're providing a lot of resources for these first responders, and so it's such a great way to minister to those who really do put their lives on the line for us. So find out more about that on your way out. Today, as we've mentioned over and over already, is Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week. This is a very busy week for us, a significant week for us. There's a lot of activities happening. Thursday, right here, we'll be having a Maundy-Thursday service at 7 p.m. Maundy's a word, it's a Latin word that means commandment. This is when Jesus celebrated Passover with his disciples, and he said, a new commandment I give you. And we're going to be talking through the Passover meal, the Seder experience. We're going to describe exactly what was going on as they celebrated Passover and then have a foot washing time as Jesus washed the disciples' feet. This will be a very meaningful service. I really want to encourage you to be here if you can at 7 p.m. for Maundy Thursday. Then on Good Friday, we're going to have a Tenebrae remembrance in the morning. So currently we're meeting every single morning at 8:30 for prayer to go through the daily office. But on Friday, we're going to modify that. It'll be a Tenebrae remembrance. And so we'll do the daily office, but it will end by reflecting on the seven last things Jesus said from the cross. We'll include, you know, the extinguishing of the candles. The room will end dark and silent. And we will leave in silence, or you can stay and pray in silence. And that'll be at 8:30 Friday morning. That will also be live streamed if you can't be here in person. And then Friday evening, I really want to encourage you all to make it to this event, the Florida Theater. It's called King Jesus. You might have seen the banners around, posters around town. It's been on the radio and on television. We'll be gathering with about 20 other churches at the Florida Theater right in the heart of our city to come together as one church and lift up the name of Jesus on the day that our Lord laid down his life for our sins. Amen. It's going to be a powerful night, and I want to encourage you, make it to the downtown Good Friday event if at all possible. Driving can be intimidating, but it's not. It's very easy. They have a parking garage. It makes it super simple to find parking and to get there. If you are intimidated about driving downtown, get with someone who you can carpool with or let Eastman Curtis know. He's going to drive the party bus, and we're going to just bus folks down there. So, try to be there if you can, Good Friday. And then, of course, Easter Sunday, the service times are all different. So you need to pay attention to this because if you show up at your normal time, you're going to be confused. So we have a 6:45 service out in the field. You know, this is our sunrise service. Then 8:30, 10 a.m., and 11:30 a.m. will be our main services right in here. Each one of those will have baptisms, Special Nation, which is our ministry to families with disabilities. That'll be happening at 10 a.m. also next door. And then at 1 o'clock, we have this Easter egg hunt. So it's going to be a great day. Make sure you take note of all those service times. Amen? Amen. Okay. Today, as I mentioned, is Palm Sunday. You all got one of these branches as you came in, hopefully, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a moment. But it was Palm Sunday when 5-year-old Jimmy was sick and had to stay home from church. And when the family returned home, they were carrying palm branches like this. And he asked his mother what they were for. And she explained that people waved them at Jesus as he walked by. And he was so disappointed. He said, "What a bummer. The one Sunday I don't go to church, Jesus shows up." Like, man, I'm pretty sure he should show up every Sunday, you know? So hopefully he shows up today. Would you stand with me for the reading of the gospel? This is in Matthew chapter 21, beginning with verse 1. "Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples saying, 'Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once.' This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet saying, 'Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming. He's coming to you humble and mounted on a donkey and on the colt, the foal of the beast of burden.' The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut palm branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, 'Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.' And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, 'Who is this?' And the crowd said, 'This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. This is the word of the Lord.'" You may be seated. The story of the Bible is God trying to establish an unshakable trust and confidence and faith in him. And that's what trust is. It's to place confidence in, to depend on, to commit or place in one's care. The whole Bible is about us learning to trust God, God building that trust in us. In the beginning, the break with God was all about a lack of trust. The thing that broke the relationship with God was man's refusal to trust God. So the serpent comes in and he begins to plant this seed of doubt to cause them to doubt that they could trust God. And he says, "Did God really say, 'Don't eat of any of the trees?'" Knowing that is not what God said. And they said, "No, God said, 'You can eat of all the trees, just don't eat of this tree.'" And the serpent says, why'd God say that? Why would God not want you to eat of that tree? He's holding out on you. See, God knows if you ate of that tree, you'd be like him. Well, they already were like him. They were created in his image. But he plants this seed of doubt and it causes them to mistrust him. The entire break with God was about a lack of trust. The Old Testament explains how God created the nation of Israel. And one of the reasons that God established the nation of Israel was to show the rest of the world what it means to be in relationship with God. Before God gave them the Ten Commandments, he delivered them out of Egypt. After he delivered them, he said, "Now, I want to tell you how to live. Not so that we can have a relationship, but because we already have one." God established the relationship with them and established himself as their deliverer. And then he says to them, "Now here's how I want you to live." God desires a relationship with us. God desires a relationship with you. I don't just mean that you have head knowledge about who God is or that you attend church. God desires a relationship with you. And he wants you to know today that he loves you. And all the things that's happening here today that we're gonna see in just a moment, all the details, and now no detail has gone unnoticed, is a way of God saying to you, "I love you." God is saying to you, "I love you." And I want you to hear that today. Just like a lack of trust broke relationship in the garden, A realignment of trust is necessary, an act of trust to reestablish relationship with him. This has been a theme in my life, just like it's been a theme throughout scripture in the lives of God's people. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, very famous passage. I have a lot of favorite passages in the Bible. I read so many of them, that's my favorite. You know, how can you not have a favorite? It's all the word of God. The only time it's not your favorite is when it says something you don't want to do and it convicts you. Well, that's not my favorite. But I would say this verse, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, is more than just a favorite. It's a life verse. It's one of those lessons that God has continued to remind me of again and again and again. Even though I think I have it, I realize I don't. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. There was a time in my life where for a solid year, no matter what I prayed about, God would bring this passage to my mind. It didn't matter what I was praying about. I was praying about my future. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. I was praying for my dad, who at that time was kind of off far away from God, and I was praying for my dad. Every time I prayed for my dad, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do you acknowledge that I have this? Trust me with this. I got this. You know, no matter what I was praying about, it was that it became irritating almost. Oh, I know what you're gonna say. Trust me, okay, I got it. But see, here's why that's so important. Because part of trusting God is to fight against the gravitational pull of our own understanding. It's to fight against the gravitational pull of our own expectations. We say we trust God, but we still lean on our own strength. We say we trust God, but we expect him to do it a certain way that we think it should look. And that's not real trust. Because real trust is laying that down. Today is the beginning of Holy Week. And I've said this over the last few weeks, that it's Holy Week because it's a week set apart from other weeks. So much of the Gospels are about the events of this week. That's how significant this week is. Today, we call it Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week, also happens to coincide with the Feast of Purim. Right now, Jewish people all over the world are celebrating the Feast of Purim. And Purim commemorates the salvation of the Jewish people from persecution and from the plot of Haman to exterminate all of them. And they have a holiday to remember how God saved them, God spared them. And even in this, remember how the Apostle Paul said, all these things are shadows. The reality, however, is in Christ. All these things are pointing us to something, even in this story. And as you read this story in Esther, and how you see there the picture of the three-day resurrection, Esther sequestered herself and she fasted for 3 days. And on the third day, she arose before the king and provided salvation for the Jewish people. The Jews on this day were delivered once again on the first fruits. The same day that Jesus brought Israel out of Egypt, the same day Jesus rose from the dead. So there's so much happening, so much timing and symbolism that's so significant. When you just look at the universe and you look at the detail of the universe, it's mind-blowing, the detail. From the farthest reaches of the universe all the way down to our DNA or to a snowflake or to a fingerprint, and you see there's so much detail. It's amazing. It's overwhelming. And when you begin to look at the events of this week, and you get a better understanding of the timing, the symbolism, and the detail that God intentionally uses, maybe we begin to realize just how much we mean to him. Maybe you will begin to realize just how much you mean to him and the great lengths that he has gone to show you that he loves you. And maybe when we understand that, we'll be able to fully place our trust completely in him. As they waved their palm branches, it meant something to them. It wasn't just random, like, hey, give me that branch, let's cut some branches down. The palm branches for them were like a flag to us. They were a symbol, a national symbol from the time of the Maccabees. It was associated with the zealots who wanted to overthrow the oppressive Roman government. as they're waving the palm branches and shouting Hosanna, which actually was the war cry of the zealots, God save us. And they would chant it over and over again. God save us, God deliver us, Hosanna. It was a war cry. They had a political expectation. See, they were waving the palm branches at Jesus and they were saying, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They're worshiping not who he was, they're worshiping what they wanted him to do. Are we any different? When we gather oftentimes, we go to church and we worship and we do different things and we volunteer for things at the church, we give to offerings, and then we expect that then God's gonna do what we want him to do. And oftentimes it doesn't work out like that. And you see in this story, what happens is the same people that are waving the branches and shouting, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. There's so much excitement. The whole city was in a stir, it said, because of this. I mean, the momentum was there and imagine how people were so excited. Those same individuals, when Jesus did not do what they expected, were the same ones that said, crucify him. Crucify him. And then prophetically they said, his blood be on us and on our children. The palm branches represent their expectations. Today I want to ask you, what are your expectations? As you come to faith, as you attend church, as you worship, as you do all these things, do you have expectations that maybe you're not aware of? People get disappointed with God because they had an expectation that wasn't fulfilled. Disappointment is unfulfilled expectations. Sometimes they're unrealistic, sometimes they're unknown. But if we're gonna fully trust him, it means we need to trust him. It means we need to lay down the palm branches of our expectations. Maybe you're expecting to be married by now and you're not. Maybe you're expecting your business was gonna take off by now and it hasn't. Maybe you're expecting to have children by now and you don't. Maybe you were expecting to not be still dealing with some of the hurt feelings that you carry from your past and they're still with you. I'm not sure what your expectations are, but to fully place our trust in him, let's lay down the palm branches of our own expectations today. When you look at the four perspectives of theological belief at the time of Jesus, there are really four categories. There were the Pharisees, and these were the legalists of their day. They believed Messiah was gonna fulfill and rule with the law. There were the Sadducees. They believed that the Messiah was gonna come from a royal line and establish a royal kingdom. It was political in nature. The Essenes, they were a pious community. They believed that the kingdom of heaven would be realized through personal piety, that the kingdom of heaven is within. And then there were the Zealots. They believed the Messiah was gonna come and overthrow an oppressive government. And all of them understood that from Scripture. All of them read Scripture and read prophecies and understood these prophecies, and then what they did is they expected it to look a certain way. What they discerned was not incorrect, it was correct, but it looked different than they expected. And when it looked different than they expected, they turned on him. I mean, in reality, they were all right. The Messiah did come to fulfill the law, but it looked different than the Pharisees thought. The Sadducees were right. He did come from a royal line to establish a royal priesthood, but it looked different than they thought. The Essenes are right. The kingdom of heaven is within us. The Zealots are right. He did overthrow the oppression of sin and death. We need to acknowledge today that we may be much like these individuals of their time, that we are worshiping, we have the Scripture, but we may be attaching our own expectations. If we're gonna trust in him with all our heart, it means we lay down our own understanding. It means we lay down our own expectations. Jesus rides in to Jerusalem on what we call Palm Sunday. And he rides in through the Eastern Gate. Here's a picture of the Eastern Gate. He rides in through the Eastern Gate. This is just across from the Mount of Olives, where it's believed the Garden of Gethsemane would have been. Jesus rides in through this gate. You know why it's sealed now? It's completely sealed up. Because when Jerusalem fell to Islamic raiders, they also knew the prophecy that Messiah would come through this gate. So they sealed it, tried to keep him out. That's pretty funny. I can't wait to see that thing blow open. That's gonna be awesome. The earth began to shake, you know the whole song? It busts open and there he comes. It's gonna be amazing. But the reason I show you this is because when they're shouting Hosanna and they're saying, you know, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And the passage that I read you, it ended with this statement. They all said this, and Matthew, Mark, and Luke all record this. They all said, who is this? Who is this? And this connects back to Psalm 24. It says this in Psalm 24 as you look at this image here. Lift up your gates, lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Who is this? They ask as Jesus rides in. This is who it is. He's the King of glory. Who is this Jesus? According to Exodus chapter 12, and I've talked about this a lot, but I have to mention it every Palm Sunday because this is part of telling the story. It wasn't Palm Sunday to them, it is to us. To them, it was Lamb Selection Day. According to Exodus chapter 12, families gathered in Jerusalem on this day to select the lamb that would be offered as a sacrifice. And it would be examined by the priests to see if it was without blemish. And if the priest approved, it would be their sacrifice. If not, the priests would provide one from the temple flock. This is one of the things Jesus gets so ticked off about on Monday. Tomorrow, when you read through your devotional guide, you'll see tomorrow he runs them out of the temple because they're exploiting the people. They're saying, no, this lamb's not good, but you can buy one of ours. Exodus chapter 12, verse 3. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of the month, every man shall take a lamb, shall select a lamb. That's what's happening on this day as Jesus rides in. As if God is saying, here's the lamb I've selected. John the Baptist said at the baptism, he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus rides in on Lamb Selection Day. And then in verse 5, it says, the lamb shall be without blemish. It was examined for a blemish and approved by the chief priests. Jesus was examined, and even his enemies could find no fault in him. He was tempted in every way, yet without sin. And then he who actually knew no sin became sin for us. God placed on him our iniquities. Peter says it this way, for you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver and gold, that you were redeemed from your empty way of life handed down from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. The lamb was then slain, slaughtered. You shall keep it until the 14th day of the month, when the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill their lambs at twilight, the moment Jesus was crucified. Leviticus says, the life of every creature is in his blood, and I've given it to you that you may make atonement for yourselves on the altar. It is the blood that makes atonement for one's life. Jesus was eternal. It was a once and for all eternal sacrifice. No more temporary sacrifices needed. The lamb was slaughtered. Jesus was mocked, beaten, flogged with a Roman 39 lashes. He was brutally beaten, laid on a cross, spikes driven through his hands and feet. But the worst of it was that the penalty of our sin was placed upon him. The prophet Isaiah, 700 years before Jesus, spoke this way about Messiah. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. And then Exodus goes on to say, and then they shall take some of the blood and put it on the doorposts and the lintel of their houses in which they eat it. See, the blood has to be personally applied. The sacrifice was for all, but it has to be personally applied. This is why you have to come to a point in your own heart where you personally trust Christ. A sacrifice is there for all, but it has to be personally applied. The blood placed on the doorposts of our lives. And then in verse 8 it says, and they shall eat the flesh of the lamb. Jesus said, eat my flesh and drink my blood, or you have no part in me. And that's why the Apostle Paul says that Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Who is this? Who is this, they ask? This is the lamb that was selected. Who is this? This is Jesus, who fulfilled over 300 Old Testament prophecies, 29 of them on the day that he died. His teachings have shaped the entire Western civilization. The Sermon on the Mount, translated more, quoted more, referenced more than any other words ever spoken. He's the one whose character was faultless. He's the one who laid down his life willingly for us. Will we lay down our palm branches? Will we lay down our own understanding? Will we lay down our expectations of who we want him to be so that we can receive who he really is? Laying down these expectations may be laying down the expectation of what we thought Jesus was going to do. It may be laying down the expectations we have of our own life. It may be laying down the expectations of others, what others think about us, what others have said about us, what others have spoken over us, what they expected us to be. We have to lay down those expectations. You know, at the time of Jesus, there were three schools in the Jewish education system of how they determined who was the brightest of the bright and the smartest of the smart. They had Bet Sefer, and this was the house of book, and everybody, every Jewish child would go through this process, and they would learn the first five books of the Old Testament. And then during that time, if you were the brightest of the bright and the smartest of the smart, you would be invited to come on to the next level, Bet Talmud. Otherwise, you would be said, oh, you need to go home and learn the trade of your dad. You need to go be an apprentice with your family. You're dismissed. You don't make the cut. And then they would go, the next level would be Bet Talmud. And this is where they would go and they would learn all the scripture, and they would memorize the Old Testament prophets and the law. And then if they discovered that they were really bright and smart, they would be invited on to Bet Midrash. But otherwise, you would be dismissed and sent back to learn the trade of your father, to be an apprentice. Only the brightest of the bright, the smartest of the smart, the elite, went to Bet Midrash. And then they were assigned a rabbi, and the rabbi would train them and live with them, and they would imitate this rabbi, and they would learn from him. Every one of Jesus' disciples, as far as we could tell, had been dismissed. They were fishermen. They were farmers. They were tax collectors. None of them, as we could tell, had been invited to this level, and these are the ones Jesus chose because God doesn't look at the things that man looks at. I'm saying that to you because maybe you feel dismissed. Maybe you feel like somebody has spoke something over you and you haven't felt qualified. And I want you to understand that today, all the details of this day are revealing to you is God's way of saying, I love you. And he's calling you to something. He's calling us to something. We need to lay down those expectations of what we think others might have even thought about us. I'm not sure which of these you relate to today. But maybe we could not be like those bandwagon fans that we read about in the Gospels. Maybe we can be like what God is calling us to in Proverbs chapter 3, to put our trust in him with all of our heart, to lean not on our own understanding, to lay down our own expectations so that we can receive who he really is. He wants us to know him, to place our trust in him. He wants you to know that he wants you. This is God's way of saying, I love you and I want to be in relationship with you. Place your trust in me. Will you do that today? And you know, this is not just about coming to faith for the first time. This is about realigning. And I have to do this so often. I've placed my trust in the Lord, but all of a sudden I realize I still have my own expectations and I'm leaning on my own understanding. I need to lay that down today, fully, completely, to place our trust in him. Will you do that also? Would you stand with me? What we're gonna do is, the worship team's gonna just lead us in a moment of worship and reflection. And during this song, I wanna encourage you to lay down your expectations. Sometimes it requires a step of us tangibly doing something. Now, you could take this home if you want to keep it as a reminder, that's fine. But I really want to encourage you, if you're at a place where you can do this, during this song, just come and whatever that might be, whatever that expectation is, some area you've been disappointed with him, disappointed with yourself, let's lay that down and let's once again trust in him with all our heart. And then Austin is going to come and lead us in communion. So Heavenly Father, I just pray for every single person that's here right now and those that are watching online. God, you know the things that we struggle with, the areas we struggle to trust you, the areas we lean on our own understanding and our own expectations. I pray, God, that by your Holy Spirit right now, you would reveal those things to us. Show us those things in our own heart, God, and give us the courage to respond in faith by laying down our expectations. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're ready to do that during this song, just come on up and leave those palm branches here at the altar. Confession together, confessing that we've all sinned and confessing Jesus as our Lord and Savior, and then we'll come and receive communion together. I'll lead you, but you pray this and you mean this in your own heart. Repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I confess that I have sinned against you in my thoughts, my words, and my actions. Have mercy on me and forgive me through your Son, my Savior. Lord Jesus, I believe you lived on this earth. You died for my sin. You rose and now live. I receive you as my Lord. Holy Spirit, fill me with power and passion to follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, we would like to invite all of you to join us in celebrating communion this morning. You should have received the communion elements as you came in through the doors this morning. If you have not, go ahead and just raise your hand up, raise it high, and our ushers will bring you the elements so you can celebrate with us this morning. After the service, after the communion liturgy, there's a spot right in front of you in your chairs, a little circle there. That's where you can put your communion elements when you're done. Now, let's not rush too quickly past this moment. Let's stay in this place of sacrifice, of laying down our expectations before the Lord. Who is this Lord? He is a gracious, gracious King. He welcomes all of us. He welcomes the broken. He welcomes those that people didn't want or didn't think were worth it. He welcomes sinners. He welcomes those who have made a big mess of their life. He lays down his life for us and he says, come, come and eat, come and feast, come to my table this morning. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Father, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, that there may be safety and blessing within the gates and walls of your holy city. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you loved us so much that even when our hearts were against you and we'd fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, in your mercy, you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to live and to die as one of us, to take the burden of our sin and our sickness upon himself and to reconcile us to you once and for all. As we break bread together today, put us in remembrance of that sacrifice and give us a greater understanding of the covenant that we now have with you. We ask that you would sanctify this bread and this cup to be for us the body and blood of your Son, our Savior, and sanctify us also so that we may faithfully serve you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. On the night that our Lord Jesus Christ was given up to suffering and death, he took bread and he broke it. You can break it with me this morning. He took it and he said, break this. This is my body which is broken for you. When you eat it, do this in remembrance of me. Let's partake together this morning. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he blessed it. He said, Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And he gave it to his disciples. He said, drink this. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. When you drink this, do it in remembrance of me. Let's drink together this morning. The Bible teaches that as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the death of our Lord until he returns. Let us stand together. And this morning, we're going to confess our faith in the form of the ancient creed, the Nicene Creed, which is shared by Christians all over this world. So let's recite this together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again, glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Amen. Please remain standing for one final song.
A few important things I want to let you know about, and then Pastor Eastman is going to pray a blessing over us to close out the rest of our day. We have many different services going on this week during Holy Week leading up to Easter Sunday, and we don't want you to miss anything. So please be sure to visit our app or our website under events, where you can find all the information about the services that Pastor Sean mentioned. We have different times, we have different things going on that we want you to be aware of. And so be sure to check out the app and the website to keep up to date with all of those. You can also find these services and times posted on our social media platforms today. So you can go and share those on your social media. You can take a screenshot of it, whatever you need to do to keep up with what's going on during Holy Week. Also, like Pastor Sean mentioned, we have at the back these devotional guides for you during this Holy Week. I encourage you. These have been crafted by our pastoral team. These are intentionally created to help you lean into what's going on during this week as we remember the events that lead up to Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. And so that's going to make Easter all the more meaningful. So you can pick up these on your way out, as well as an invite card. Be sure to take some of these, pass them out to your friends, your neighbors. Easter is a great, great Sunday to invite people for whatever reason. You can get people in church that don't normally come to church for Easter. So be sure to grab some of those on your way out as you leave today. Also, we are going to be having some baptisms happening on Easter Sunday. And so if you would like to register to be baptized, you can do so today by going online or in our church app. And then immediately following this service over in our Kids Adventures room, we are having a baptism class. So you can join us for that, learn more about what baptism is, ask your questions, and be ready for next Sunday to be baptized. We're excited to be standing with you in that exciting step of your faith journey. Also on Sunday, April 7th, we are going to be having child dedications in the middle of our service, or as a part of our worship service. This is something new, something we haven't done before, and so we are looking forward to that. If you would like to register your child to be dedicated, you can do so on the app or the website. And then for anything else that's going on here at Redeemer, the app and the website are the best ways to stay connected here at Redeemer. Pastor Eastman.
Sam, thank you. What an awesome, awesome Palm Sunday. Amen. And it's not even over yet. Good things are happening. What a way to kick off Holy Week. We're so excited that you joined us today. And also you on the internet, thank you for being a part of us here. We're so excited for you guys. But listen, if you need prayer today, and we have our prayer teams that are up here at both sides, they'd love to agree with you in prayer and release the power of God. So many miracles happen. When two or three or four or five or six people agree in prayer, the power of God is released. And we encourage you to share your prayer requests with some of the folks here. We're going to release God's power. Well, I want to right now pronounce God's blessings on you. Would you receive this? Get ready for a great Holy Week and a fantastic Easter. Shut your eyes, and if you would, lift a hand up toward heaven as you feel comfortable. Just hold it up high and just receive this. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. Have a great Holy Week, you guys.